He is going to be showing us how to turn practicing our instrument into a game, which is super cool. Yep. So it's all you.
All right. So, hello, everybody. Thank you for joining. Now, today, I'm basically just going to be tackling practice, because for some people, it's really difficult to keep a routine and a regimen regularly and get regular practice in. Of course, when you're learning an instrument or singing or anything like that, practicing is very key if you want to get better, learn new songs and whatnot like that. Plus, especially if you're performing, you want to make sure you have the songs in your head and you go over them over and over and over again, whether you're doing open mics, or hopefully somewhere down the line we'll start up concert classes again and such like that. So I have a question for you guys to start off. So if you want, you can raise your hand or unmute yourself or go into the chat, whatever you'd like. What are some of the biggest obstacles you have with practicing an instrument?
Getting started.
Okay, that's a good one. So motivation is always key. And this is where this whole kind of like game idea comes from. So you could just raise your hands. Anybody who plays any kind of games or used to play games or anything like that, like video games or anything. I do. So the kind of games I'm talking about are the kinds where like you're developing yourself as a character, right? So you have like, say, levels, you grow levels, you get better, whatever the case may be in the said game. So that's going to be kind of how I'm going to show you how you can keep track of your progress, because sometimes things can take a long time to learn and it can be very frustrating, especially when you feel like you're not getting any better. And that's probably the most discouraging thing I've found, is when you feel like you haven't gotten better. So I'll show you a couple of ways that you can keep track of it. You could challenge yourself, you could set goals. And most importantly, you need to reward yourself. So when you reach that goal, don't just like leave it and continue. You gotta make sure you reward yourself, because that reward is what's gonna motivate you to keep going. And sometimes rewards could be in the shape of performing live, because anyone who's performed live, and if you haven't, this is something you should hear, is it feels very good. It's a certain feeling that only musicians who perform live, or actors or anybody in the arts, can experience and feel. It's such a rush and it's so much fun. So everyone wants to get to that point. So is there any other obstacles or like difficulties in practicing from anyone?
I would say endurance is probably a big thing.
Yeah, that's a good point too, because you could learn how to say, I see a couple drummers here, for example. When you're drumming, it's not just about learning a beat, it's about learning that beat and keeping it for like 4 minutes straight. For guitar players, it's not just learning chords and how to switch them, it's about being able to play the chords and keeping going for the whole song. So like Morgan was showing her fingertips, your fingers will hurt, especially if you're new, you have to develop calluses, or else, like before then your fingers are sensitive, and that's why it's important to practice regularly. The more you practice, the faster those calluses grow in, the less it hurts. Plus your strumming arm, strumming for like 3-4 minutes can get really tiring for your shoulders. So we're gonna talk about how you can practice endurance and being able to play for longer periods of time. Okay, so I'm just going over my little list here. So how we're gonna make it like a game. So I'm gonna show you guys a couple of different things. It's okay to share a screen, right? Okay, so over here, let me just pull up, because first off, we have, for our drummers, I like this page here. So you go to YouTube, you could use backing tracks. I like this drumless backing track page, where it just gives you like songs and tracks to play to. You could practice a beat. So if you learn a new beat, like a rock beat, you could just go to down here. And you can see there's, yeah, let me just skip ahead. There's no drums. So when you learn a new beat, you could practice your drum beat along to that and just work on keeping time as an example. So how to use a metronome. Let's start with that, because a metronome is very key for any instrumentalist. Let's go over here. So I'm going to show you how to use a metronome. Now, I have drummers, I have guitar players, ukulele, and a piano player here. I don't want you to. So I'm going to show you and demonstrate a couple of ways how you could practice. So when you want to practice, for example, chords, okay, I'll pull out a ukulele. Because why not? So you're learning some new chords and you're learning how to switch between them. So before you learn songs, you have to learn your chords. Now, the hardest part about being able to switch chords quickly is being able to move everything, all your fingers, and repositioning them in time with the beat and being able to keep up with the song. So to do that, you have to build muscle memory. So to do that, I like to pair up chords. So let's say you have a G and a C. So what you could do is you start off nice and simple. I don't know if it's gonna come out like in time on your end because of the latency here, but it'll be kind of the same in reference to the metronome. So you could play one strum per click. I usually like to do four and switch. Now, for some people, that might be too quick to start with, and that's okay. You can start as slow as you want. But here's where the whole keeping track thing comes in. You find your speed for switching a chord where it's comfortable. And then you do that, like you keep switching over and over again for, let's say, a couple minutes, 2-3 minutes. If it's no problem, super easy, speed up by 5 or 10 beats per minute each time. Now, the speed between, let's say, 70 and 80, or not 70, yeah, 60 and 70, let's say. So listen to the speed. Now I'll go up to 70. Now listen to the difference. There's almost no difference, it seems like, right? You hear it, sounds like it's almost the same speed. So the reason why I say that is because when you're practicing the switching and you increase it by 10, it doesn't feel like you're going that much faster, but you are. And then you cross out a 60, like I like to keep a page, you can keep track of everything. You have your 60 beats per minute, cross it out, put 70. And then as the days go on, you might get from 70 to 75 to 80 to 85. And after a week or two, you might feel like you haven't really gotten that much faster, but when you look at the numbers, you have. It's right there in front of you. You can't argue with the numbers. So that's one of the things that'll help keep you from being discouraged, because even when you feel like you're not getting better, you are, it's right in front of you. Now, with a metronome, you can do it like that. You can double the speed, but if by going up and down or whatever you want, I'll show different examples or a couple examples later. But the whole point of this is you're gonna start nice and slow, whatever you're learning. If you're a drummer, you're learning a new beat. Maybe you're learning a new rudiment. I'm gonna travel a little bit to the drums here for my drummer friends. I'm going to remove my headphones. I'm going to try to play quietly, but who knows how this will turn out. Again, metronome is your best friend. Let's say I wanted to play like a rock beat. So I know the drummers that already know this beat, but this is just an example. You can apply it to anything, right? Right? So you play a beat, you play it for a couple minutes straight, and then when it's no more problems, increase it by 10. Right? Now, again, not that much difference in speed, but you could do any of your beats with this. So let's say you have three beats, practice them all at a speed that you're comfortable with, mark down the numbers of the BPMs beside each one, and then you could practice as you go, increase your numbers, set your goals. Goals are important. Whenever you're practicing anything, or you're learning a new song or whatever, set goals for yourself. That way you have direction. If you don't have direction, you might feel like there's too much going on, overwhelming. So that's very important. Let me see. Like I said about rewards, you set your goals, you achieve your goals, you reward yourself. And your goals can be set. You can have your teacher set your goals, but sometimes you want to make little steps to get to that bigger goal. So let's say here's a song. Okay, a song's played at whatever speed. Start the song at a slower speed. And when you start slow and go faster, that's how you can play more cleanly. You don't want to try and push yourself, rush too much, too quickly, because even if you could play fast enough, it's not going to come out very clean. And that was my mistake when I was first learning, because when I started, I was all about speed. No matter what I played, I started on piano, I went to drums, and then bass and guitar, and all I wanted to do was play fast. And I know a bunch of people can relate to that, but I was always given the advice that if you can't play fast, or if you can't play slow, you can't play it fast. So, you know, try to start slow and don't let yourself get faster until you can play it slow and increase a little bit at a time. So is there any questions so far about anything I've talked about? Anybody want to say anything?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that start slow and increase, that's a good learning for me, because typically when you sit down to learn a song, you want to play it just the way it is. Like, like I want it to sound exactly like it is off the record, and maybe I haven't got the, you know, the progressions down well enough to be able to play at that speed.
So yeah.
I get frustrated.
Yeah.
And then that's when I step away.
Yeah. And I can definitely understand that, because I've always been that person that pushed myself a little bit too hard. And that's another thing too, is try to ease up on yourself. We're all our worst critics, you know. We're all very negative inside as musicians. If anybody who's been playing an instrument for a while understands what I'm talking about, everyone wants to be perfect. Everyone wants to be that, you know, glorified rock star or whatever, but you gotta understand that it takes time, a lot of time, but the reward is very great. It's very unique. Things that you could do as a musician, you can't do anywhere else. You know what I mean? Like, how often can someone perform in front of potentially thousands of people, have thousands of people cheer, right? Or just create something. You create your own music. You create something and then you can release it, distribute it, I know there's other arts that can do the same thing, but you know, like in plays and drawing a blank on the word, but you know, singing Broadway, you know, you can perform in front of people and stuff like that. But there's something different about music, you know, especially most people are really connected to music, you know, different genres and whatnot, but everyone loves music. There's something about it that connects us all. So it's really cool. Now, you're talking about the, you know, learning a song and you want to play the song, you know, up to speed right away, but you got to like take a step back, start slow, build yourself up. Now, sometimes I've come across this situation where the song's not that difficult, or you've worked hard, you got there, but there's like that one part, that one part that like just throws you off for whatever reason.
E minor. Right?
Guitar players, maybe it's the lead part. For drummers, maybe it's that one fill or like an off time shot. For ukulele players, maybe it's that one, you know, you got your A minor, C, and then you got this thing going on. Mm-hmm. And it's like, what? So I'm going to spend a minute talking about that. Some experience I've gained, like remember how I said I'm one of those people that likes to push myself beyond, and I always was wired for speed. And I had to really learn how to tone that back. Because of that, the things that I've taught myself or learned are very ridiculous, but to scale it back, to be able to play it, you remove that part from a song. So let's say guitar players, you're playing a solo, but there's that one part of the solo that's just like, you can't get it for whatever reason. Speed, just a weird bend, twist, I don't know, whatever. You take that little section and you remove it and you practice it over and over and over again by itself. So if you give me a second real quick, I'm gonna go grab my guitar and kind of demonstrate something. Okay. So let's say you have this lead going and it's like, you know, no problem. Right? And then all of a sudden there's this weird thing. Right? And it's like, what the heck just happened? So you take that little part, right? Or whatever it was, I just made it up on the spot. But so you take that little part and you slow it right down and you practice it over and over again. And you do that metronome method that I was talking about before. Now with the rewards, let's say the first reward would be getting it up to speed, okay? The second step, after you reward yourself, the second step is intricating it with the rest of the solo. So now you have to practice coming out of it. Let's say doing that first. So you start on the hard part, and then you play the part after, and you add that to it, and you repeat that over and over again. And then you take the part before the hard part, and you add that, and you practice it over and over again. Because sometimes just because you could play that one part now doesn't mean you could just throw it in the solo perfectly. You got to work around it as well. So that's another important part. With drummers, same idea. You got a crazy drum fill coming. You got to take that fill and you practice it over and over again. So I'm going to move back to the drums. I'm just going on tour over here. Yeah, see if I can get enough of this kit in view. So, like, I don't know. Nothing like too crazy, but like, let's say it's just a drum roll, like, right? And right now, let's say you're learning it, and the first thing you do is like, you know that's not up to speed. So the first task is you get that metronome, practice to it. You do it over and over, get a little faster after a while. Then after you get up to speed, now you got to practice the beat maybe coming out of it. So then you practice that over and over again till it's stuck in your head. Then you got to practice going into it. So you start with the beat. Then you just practice that. And then you practice the before and the after with it. So I found that that's the quickest way to getting that one little hard spot in a song, whether it's a weird chord change, a weird little lead run, or whatever, and trying to get it so that you can play the rest of the song, because nothing is more annoying than working very hard to learn a song and there's that one spot that becomes your nemesis forever. So that way you can have no nemesis. Nemesi. Whatever. Whatever the multiple of nemesis is. So that's my take on that. Let me think. For backing tracks, I've pulled these up. Now we went over a bit on the metronome, right? Which you can use when you're learning new chords to switch. You can learn or use it when you're practicing whole progression on a song. So like, I want to demonstrate that for you, how that looks. Let's go to like, oh, that's not a number, but okay, knew what I meant. Make sure you guys can still hear me, okay. Let's say, just throw some easy chords here. Before everyone goes insane with the method. Like, so I'm just using for the guitar players there who I already know, but everyone else, there's a G, D, and C chords, pretty standard, used quite a bit. And the down, or the strumming pattern, down, down, up, up, down, up. So just a little quick reminder, when you're learning that strumming pattern, remember all the downs land with the click, right? Click, 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 but like the one down, you don't hit the clicks in between, but that's left for an actual lesson. But let's say the strumming, whether it's the strumming that's too hard at that fast or the chord switching. Dial it back to whatever's comfortable. Why is it? Go away! All right, I don't know. There we go. Okay. So you start off just. Once you get that speed, you do your whole, all right, let's, whoa. My keyboard is going crazy. There we go. Then you go up by 10. And so on and so forth. And you work your way up. Sometimes maybe going up by 10 is too much too fast, so just drop it back to 5. So you go from like say 70 to 75, 75 to 80, and you work your way up to that 140 beats per minute. Now, some of you are probably wondering, how do I figure out the speed of a song? All right, I'm gonna show you that. Same way I figure it out. Anyone have a request for a song? Leland, is that your hand up? I don't know. Can you unmute him? Maybe.
Can you say it, honey?
Corn.
So we just started a song on drums. So I'll just do this real quick at the beginning here. Sure, it's creepy doll. So this is how you figure out the tempo. Basically, whatever you want to like nod your head to or tap your foot is generally your body's natural ability to find the tempo. I'll just kind of wait for this to kick in. So you want to bang your head like that, right? All right. There's the BPMs. So if you're practicing the beat, right? That might be a little bit too fast to start with. So you roll back. So if this is your BPMs, then you have to figure out a speed that matches that. So you can either, if you can't keep that in your head, record yourself or like have someone else do this or like tap your foot while you go to the metronome, and let's say 80. So I got my foot going, I don't know if you can hear. Way too slow. So let's go up. That's pretty close. That might be a little bit fast. But that's close enough. So there, 120 for that song, that would be your goal. So you write down 120 beats per minute beside the song, and then you take the beat, dial it back to whatever your comfortable speed is, start there, start working your way up. And you can start like leveling yourself up. Make little goals every week, okay? You don't wanna go from, especially if you're a beginner, say, 60 beats per minute to 120. That's doubling your speed in 1 week. That's pretty tough. Unless you want to like sit on your drums and practice for 8 hours a day, then you have blisters, then you can't play for a while. So you got to balance all that out. Try to set a goal from 60 to 80 in that first week, you know, 80 to 100 the second week. And as you practice more and more and more, the time it takes to get better will become less. So that's for metronomes. Now, I kind of showed some stuff for the drummers. Like I said, with this page here, drumless backing tracks, it's got all kinds of cool stuff. If you want, let me move this. Got some funk. You got rock backing tracks, funk, metal, reggae.
You can find backing tracks for anything too. You can find them for guitar, for piano, for ukulele.
Oh yeah, that's actually, I was going through each one. Sorry. I got them all ready to go. So there was one specifically I brought up. I can't remember now, but it was the reason why I actually like this, because it gives you bar counts on some of them. I think this might be one of them. So for a drummer, that's pretty cool, because if you want to like, so there's no drums, you come up with your own beat, or you can practice a beat you learned before this, and now you're not just playing to a metronome, you got an actual groove going, which is a lot more fun if you're going to be experimental. So you know when the music's gonna change. So at the end, when you get to that last bar, practice the drum fill. You know? going to try to have a couple of recordings pre-made to demonstrate what you could do with it. But unfortunately, when I was playing with headphones, you can't hear the backing track. And if I take out the headphones and play the drums, you can't hear the backing track. So just try and have fun with it on your own, you know, any beat, especially if it's just like that, you know, four beats per bar at 1, 2, 3, 4, you can put that to anything. Start with that. And then you can just kind of groove to it, add stuff as you go. That's just as you're like progressing through it. Goals that you could set for yourself. You can get yourself to this point, work towards it. Like I was saying earlier, direction, set a direction for yourself. You pick your goals, you pick your directions. Then you're kind of like going towards a certain way rather than everything sort of sitting in front of you and seeming like too much and overwhelming. Now over here for guitar players who want to practice soloing, when you learn your pentatonic scale, and of course piano, you could do this as well. When you want to learn little runs or just jam on your own. Now we have a rhythm section. You got a little 12 bar blues here. You hit your chords. I know what key you're in. You got your beat per minute and all that stuff. Right, but of course, you can go guitar. You got like, you could pick any key you want, you could pick any genre you want. You have hard rock, soulful groove. So the cool part is they also give you notes you can play. Right here. So you got the chords you're gonna follow, the notes you have available to solo over these chords. So you can kind of mess around with them like that. And it just goes on. You can pick anything you want. You could be creative, or you could just use it to practice little ditties that you're learning, right? And then over here, some of you might not be interested in playing leads. You just want to do chords, strumming along like an acoustic or a ukulele. So this is drums only. I'm going to try something. Show of hands or thumbs. Can you guys hear the drum still? Yeah?
No.
No?
Barely. Aaron, if you share screen and go to advanced and share audio only, it's a lot better.
Where's the...
I don't know where that is.
Does that enable original sound? No. Where did you go, Morgan?
No, I think you would have to stop sharing and then do a new share.
Okay.
Hi.
Like, set it before I share? No, it didn't change.
And then when you go to share screen, you go to the advanced. It says basic, advanced, and fine.
Oh, okay. So advanced, all I get is who can share and how many participants. I don't know.
You should see music or computer sound only.
No, I do not. Oh, got it. Okay. Well, the reason why I was going to is because when it shares, like you can hear it, there's a lag to it. So I was gonna like strum chords. It's kind of heavy. But you can go backing track, drums only. You got chill rock, groove. Hey, look, you have Rush there. Yeah, and then those are some of the other ones I already looked up. But what you could do with that is practice your strumming to it as well. If you can get up to the speed with the metronome. Hey, look at that. Man, that's even more of a beat. So it's probably going to be a little delayed on the video. I don't know. Turned out on your guys' end, but that's just sort of an example of you could look up these backing tracks and just practice switching. Like, remember how before I was talking about learning new chords, you switch between two to get the muscle memory. So you can use those backing tracks to switch and practice before you practice the full song. That way you can still practice the chords with a groove, and it's more entertaining than a metronome. So use the metronome to get yourself up to speed. You can use backing tracks to practice individual chords, build up the muscle memory of all those chords, then you can jump to your song. So everyone's different, you know, everyone has different ways of learning. So some people, maybe they just want to learn like all the, well, not all, but like a bunch of chords first, just so they're prepped and ready to go. You can do that. You can learn a bunch of chords. You can use these examples, the metronome, the jam tracks, to practice switching between all of them. And then the benefit of that, of course, there's pros and cons, good and bad to everything. The benefit, the good part of that, is when you want to start learning songs, then you'll just be able to bang them out real fast because you already have all the chords down. Of course, the con, the downside, is it could be boring because you're only playing chords, nothing really specific. But some people might enjoy that. They might enjoy that kind of structure of the bass foundation before jumping into songs. Some people would rather just do songs and forget about everything else until you get there. And that's cool. These tools you can use whichever way you want to go. And that's basically, like I said, with that combined with that system where you actually mark down this, like the BPMs, that you're playing everything, starting slow, building yourself up to speed, and taking a long time to get there. Don't rush. And that's how you can play cleanly as well, because if you just rush it, then you might be stumbling a little bit, or with the drums, you might, you know, skip a beat. Maybe your right leg doesn't want to match with your left arm as properly as you want it to, right? So you take your time with the drums, you know, make sure everything's nice and solid, then you can, you know, build it up in speed. And with the endurance, here's the other side. Instead of just trying to go faster, you can time yourself, right? So if you're gonna play chords for a song, let's say you could play, you know, the G, C, and D chords, no problem. It's just now you have to learn how to play it for 4 minutes straight. Do the same thing. You find your BPMs for the song, time yourself. Okay, today I was able to do it for 30 seconds before my shoulder got tired. All right, next day try for 45 seconds. You know, a couple days later, try to aim for a minute and a half. And you build yourself up that way. And some people will just fly through it, and that's fine. But eventually everyone's gonna reach a point where you're going to find something specifically difficult. Everybody has mental blocks. The best way to get better is to find them and focus on them. In my opinion, anyways, you could take the easiest stuff that you know already and you could play with it, you could learn songs, and that's fun. It's fantastic. If you want to get better, you're going to have to push yourself just a little bit harder, go outside your comfort zone, et cetera, et cetera. Does anyone else have any questions or comments about anything that I've said? Yes, Leland. Can I unmute? I cannot.
It's not. I could not.
Okay, that's all right.
Leland's unmuted.
He was.
Oh, he changed his mind.
Yeah. Anyone else?
No. Is rewarding yourself with cheesecake still effective?
Yeah. Yeah. Most definitely. I'm down for that.
I'm totally down for that. Totally.
Yeah. Whatever motivates you, right? You want to reward yourself. Maybe someone was like, hey, there's like these really nice pair of pants or whatever that I want at this store, or this new guitar might be a little bit much at first, but you know what I mean? You set goals for yourself and achieve them, and then you can treat yourself with how you
wine.
See
wine.
Wine, there you go. Some of the underage kids might not be appropriate there, Deep.
Also PS4 time.
More PS4 time. There you go.
That's not bad.
Yeah.
Or how about being able to play that song at our next virtual open mic?
There you go.
Ooh.
Yeah. That's a big reward too.
Or an isolated melody project, right?
Exactly. But I'm just talking about the milestones to get to that song, right? You got to keep yourself motivated to get there. And then once you get that song, yeah, jam it, perform it. Know what it's like to play in front of people and have them react. Because I know there was already a webinar about your fear of performing. And this is a great way to get over that. Because, you know, 95, 99% of the time you perform, you come out of it feeling amazing. You know, like you're terrified when you start. And I've been there. I was so bad that in grade 9, in music class, I wasn't even performing, it wasn't on stage, music class, the teacher asked us to play a beat on the drums to make sure that we can play a beat, and that was it. And I was more than capable, right? But there was a guy in front of me and he played something, and it wasn't anything crazy, but in my head I was like, whoa, this guy's way better than me, I don't want to be embarrassed, I don't want to get in front of people, blah blah blah. And I ended up waiting until everyone was lining up and leaving. And then I played. And like, I guess some of the people caught me while they were leaving. And they were like, why didn't you just play in front of everybody? Like, that sounded great. So before, how I mentioned, you know, you're your own worst enemy. That is all in your head, the whole performance thing. And the feeling you get afterwards, after that achievement, is just phenomenal. Like, it's very difficult to get that feeling anywhere else in the world, really, in my opinion, from my experiences. You know, even playing stuff, like I've played stuff that was kind of like I was filling in for a band, and you know, it wasn't exactly my thing what I was doing. It's still fun. I still had a blast, you know. And then you could just get up on stage and perform, and I love being a goof on stage. And it's just, once you laugh it off, and especially interacting with the crowd, you realize they're not like these judgmental people that are just out to get you. They're there to have fun with you and see you and enjoy everything, right? So, you know, that's why it's really good to, we try to get people to introduce, you know, themselves or songs in open jams and open mics, whatever, you know, just as a formality, but really you should take the opportunity to say a thing or two, or, you know, be silly, whatever, let that out. And then you'll see how rewarding it is. Yeah, just, so I think I did that recap. Sorry. Yes, Anne?
Yay, can I unmute myself? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so thank you for talking about the fear factor and the stage fright and the Rice Krispies things. And I was thinking a lot about it today because I did the open jam with my husband, the virtual jam, for the first time, right, Morgan? And I was scared. And I performed in front of thousands of people because it was live. I had no control over what was happening. My drummer was playing guitar, which is a very weird thing, because when we record at our house, we can just do a take until it's perfect and then post it. But this was live. And it was really cool to see the dynamic of how somebody who, you know, is a seasoned veteran, and how my fear came up inside of me. And I had said, or I'd mentioned in my talk about fear being forget everything and run. Mm-hmm. And today I heard a really good acronym for fear is face everything and rise.
Yeah.
Rise up against it, rise up and face whatever it is that you, and I thought that was incredible. I had goosebumps and I was like, I'm going to face everything and rise up. So it's propelling me. And I love that you're doing this whole thing with the metronome thing because yes, my husband is a drummer, but I never practice with a metronome.
Yeah.
Right. I know, Morgan, I'm getting the thing, but I practice with my husband who is like his own metronome. But he can't always be here, and hearing that tick, 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 it's so good. It's so good. And thank you for sharing on how, you know, some people are like, ooh, how do you find the BPMs? But just to, you follow your bouncing head. That's what you do. And what is your head doing? Start clapping. And that's how you find the
exactly. beat.
I'm sorry I came in late, but what I heard was awesome. Thank you. I enjoyed this. It's really cool. Face everything. And rise up. Yeah.
Actually, I was gonna build off that one. There's a couple of fears that I've overcome in my life. One of them was performance. The other one was roller coasters that go upside down. I was terrified as a kid of that. It was actually in like grade 11 in high school. I finally went on my first ride. Like any rides, I went upside down. And of course, after I did that, I realized it was all in my head. And now I'm like a ride monster. Like I just want to ride everything. Same with music, right? You start performing, you just want to perform all the time. But it's like the best feeling comes from facing your fears and conquering them. I even think I saw like Will Smith or whatever, like randomly do a little like speech about it, like a selfie video or whatever, where he says like the best happiness is on the other side of fear. So, you know, face everything and rise, you face your fears. It's like a massive amount of like weight being lifted off your shoulders and a sense of freedom, I guess. So again, with the performance thing, because I know a lot of people are afraid of performing, that kind of goes with that as well. Anyone else?
Just do it. It's
yeah,
okay.
Just do it. Nike.
You'll throw up in your mouth. You'll be fine. You'll get through it. Yeah. It happens.
Well, hey, if anyone saw me playing at the first open jam online, like the virtual one, and I played like that song that I wrote, I was totally unprepared, but I just thought, whatever, I'd give it a shot. And I messed up so much. But what did I do? I laughed about it. I made a joke like, oh, my God. And I just kept going because, like, whatever. Right? You laugh about it. You have fun.
And I find like, too, is if – we had talked about having confidence in what you're doing and like knowing that we're all here. Everybody that's here watching you is not judging you. Mm-hmm. The people that come to see you at shows or come to see, you know, the kids at the, you know, oh my gosh, concert class and all that other stuff. We're all here to be entertained. And we're all doing this together and you will be someone's inspiration in that day. Like that today, I was talking to a friend and they had said, you know, my acronym for fear is face everything and rise up. And I was like, oh, I totally needed to talk to you today so I can share that because it works. It's so good. The Music Depot crew, like everybody here and all the students, the parents, Morgan, Jack, everybody's incredible. And all we want you to succeed. Even the teachers are in on everybody else's webinars because I totally learned something today too. I think it's awesome.
Well, good job. Thank you. To enforce the, remember how I was talking about the practicing the backing tracks too, when you're just learning something and whatnot, that also creates a familiar atmosphere because sometimes you can't play, especially right now, you can't play with people. And you're talking about how your husband's not always there to play the drums when you play. And of course, real people is always 100 times more fun when you get a group together and you're all meshing and all that stuff. But when you play to those backing tracks, another thing is when you mess up, which everyone does, you can learn how to come back in, right? So it's nobody's perfect. Everyone makes mistakes. But what I like to encourage is how to make mistakes gracefully. So I'm not impressed by someone who could play something perfectly. I'm impressed by someone who could play something, mess up and come out of it so smoothly that no one knows that they messed up in the first place.
Yeah.
Right? That to me is very impressive, more so than being perfect. So that, practicing with the backing tracks, whether you're just strumming chords, leads, whatever, you can get more of the feel of how to come back in or correct a mistake and just do that. And then, of course, that'll help with your confidence later on when you go to perform, because now you know, well, if I might make a mistake, you know, what do I do? Am I going to freeze? No, you can just groove with it and jam and keep going. So, yeah, basically that's my bit on practicing. It's very important to practice regularly and keep a routine, give yourself some goals, stick to those goals, reward yourself when you get there, start slow and build up slowly. But not only about building up the speed to your goals, but also the endurance. You time yourself, but make it realistic so you can achieve these goals. And the more you achieve these goals, the better you'll feel. Don't set unrealistic goals because that'll just discourage you. Keep it nice and small. And then you'll get better faster because you're not getting as discouraged. You know, you're not putting your instrument down and walking away for 4 days. You know, and you're more focused on what you got to do. And you'll also be playing more cleanly too, because you can play not just one speed of the song, you can play all the speeds, the same thing. So it was a pleasure talking to everybody. It's great seeing you all come out. Thank you very much. I hope you all have a good day, good weekend. And I'll see pretty much all of you at some point next week.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Aaron. That was awesome.
You're welcome.
See you about it.
See you.
Thanks, Aaron.